Could you really become a hypnotist in just a few minutes? Hi there, this is James Tripp, and welcome to this video, which is called Become an Instant Hypnotist or Easy Hypnosis with Monoideism. Now, if you're new to hypnosis, this could very well be, what I'm going to share with you in this video could very well be your first hypnotic experiment, your first hypnotic success indeed, because this is something that's very easy to make work and make work well. If you're a bit more of a seasoned pro, I'm hoping there's something in this for you too, a different way of looking at hypnosis, a little thing that you can drop in, you can make very casual, very easy. But either way, before I get into showing you what I'm going to show you, I just want to thank everybody who last week applied for the Power of Eight Hypno Creators group. So I had a lot of applicants, a lot of really good applicants. I filled the group. The thing is, I've got some people I'd love to offer places to, but the group is full. So what I'm doing is I'm considering doing a second group to run concurrently. So if you missed out on the Power of Eight, you'd like to apply, and you didn't get around to applying, please do, because if I get enough people to do a second group, enough good people, I will do a second group. Okay, so going beyond that, we're looking at this idea, monoideism, simple hypnosis with monoideism, and how to become an instant hypnotist. Now, if you're new to hypnosis, there's a good chance a lot of the ideas you have about hypnosis come from TV, from films, from popular culture, all of this kind of thing. You've probably got an idea of hypnosis being about mind control. As I've said elsewhere, hypnosis isn't really about mind control. We are influencing people's minds. We are influencing people's perceptions, but we're not controlling. Okay, so we're artfully influencing. There's a big difference here. And what I'm going to share with you here is an experiment in this kind of influence in a very kind of overt, very easy way. But it's a useful way of demonstrating to people how their mind and their body is connected. How as the mind flows, the body follows. So I'm going to share this idea with you right here. And it's based on James Braid's conceptualization of monoideism. So to say something very quickly about that, James Braid is often said to be the guy that coined the term hypnosis or hypnotism in the English language. And there's a little bit of controversy around that, but he's often said to be the guy that did that. And he had an idea that hypnosis was a special state of neurological sleep when he started out researching hypnosis, but he ended up abandoning this idea. Now, people are not so familiar with his later work, so they don't know necessarily that he abandoned this idea. He abandoned this idea and came to conclude that hypnosis was really about the mind wrapping around a single idea, or a very narrow set of ideas, to the point where that idea became vivid and real and took over their reality. Now, this largely concurs with how I think about hypnosis. If you are familiar with the Hypnosis Mastery Program, any of my home study materials, you'll know this concurs with my view of hypnosis. Also, by the way, I'm going to say this is not actually different from everyday life, because we get caught up in ideas all the time which shape our experience. This is why if somebody shows up somewhere thinking they're not going to be welcome, they show up feeling like, because the idea they're not going to be welcome shapes their experience, for example. Or if they show up and they're going to give a presentation and they feel they're really going to crush it, the idea that they're really going to crush it shapes their experience and shapes how they show up and engage. So hypnosis is working with our innate reality-shaping faculty, as I often put it. And this little experiment I'm going to share with you here works with this idea, monoideism, and works with it very explicitly and very directly. So what we're going to do here is we're going to do a very classic thing, a very classic hypnosis piece. We're going to do a hand levitation. We're going to set somebody up so they have an experience of their hand floating up all by itself. And we are going to do it in the simplest way possible. Now, I'm not going to go into great detail. This isn't a set of instructions. It's a concept. I want you to approach it as a concept. Really get the concept in your mind, really get the concept in your heart and your body, and start to experiment with it. Allow your languaging, how you communicate with somebody when you lead them through this, allow it to flow in a way that just moves towards the outcome. The outcome is we want to have somebody have an experience of their hand lifting up all by itself. So, first of all, As I outline in incredible detail in the Hypnosis Mastery Program, one of the most important phases of setting up a hypnotic experiment is the setup and pre-frame. And I don't want to go too deeply into this here because I cover this in depth in the Hypnosis Mastery Program. But when we're doing any kind of hypnosis, what we need to do is we need to work with people's ideas. We need to put ideas in people's minds that are going to help them make sense of what is happening. Because if we do not steer the sense they are making, they will make their own sense, which may or may not align with what we want. So it's really important when we start out that we're going to help them make sense of what's about to happen. Now, if you're a seasoned hypnotist and you're very comfortable working in hypnosis frames, for sure, in your setup and pre-frame, talk about hypnosis. Set it up as, let's do some hypnosis, a little bit of a hypnotic experiment, something like this. But if you are new to hypnosis, I'm going to recommend that you don't do this. Why? Because you're likely to be working with a friend or family member or something like this, and they're not likely to believe that you have the capacity to hypnotize. So if you tell them what you're going to do is hypnosis, you're likely to evoke a lot of skepticism from them. This is a very typical thing, and they won't buy in and they won't engage in a way that they experience the effect as it should be. So I'm going to suggest you steer away from hypnosis frames if you are not known as a hypnotist, if you're not used to playing with these frames. But when you sit down with somebody to do this, invite them, say, would you be interested? I want to try something out, a mind-body experiment. Okay, so talk about a mind-body experiment and say it's to do with how, where your mind flows, your body follows, your physiological responses follow. You could even talk a little bit about placebo if you want here as part of the setup. So, you know, placebo, when somebody gets placebo medicine, their mind responds to the idea that it's medicine, it's going to have a physiological effect, and it does so. Because of what the mind believes. This is an everyday phenomenon. So this could be part of your pre-frame here. So would you be up for experiencing something interesting? Now, when you say that, you want to get a clear and congruent yes. You want somebody to say yes. You want to hook their curiosity. This is an important thing. Again, I talk about all of this stuff in the Hypnosis Mastery Program, so I'm covering it very quickly here. You want to hook their curiosity. You want to get that buy-in with the clear and congruent yes. If at this point somebody says, oh, I'm a bit busy at the moment, or I'll tell you what, don't chase them for it. It's always stronger when you hook curiosity and somebody comes to you. You want somebody to sit down, interested, willing to engage fully. You cannot hound them into this or hassle them into this. If they're in a hurry, if they want to get through it, it's not going to work. One of the golden rules of doing hypnosis is the person that you're working with, you want them to get into the experience, not get through the experience. So if they're in a kind of like, well, I'm in a hurry, it's not going to work well. So get this setup done. And then when they agree, say, okay, what I'd like for you to do is just very lightly rest your fingertips on the table or on their leg if there's no table around. You want to get them to have, if this is the surface, you want their fingertips rested lightly. Now, the reason you're getting the fingertips rested lightly is because you want the muscles of the arm engaged. You want them already switched on because we're going to utilize the firing of the muscle fibers based upon an idea to get the hand lifting. And if the arm is very, very relaxed to start with, you've got a lot more work to do. So get it set up like this so the muscles are engaged to start with. Now, the next thing we're going to do is we are going to make an invitation to the person we are working with. And it is an invitation to be taken by an idea, to be had by an idea fully and completely. So remember this idea from James Braid, monoideism. What we're doing with this piece is taking this quite literally. It's an idea and we want them to be taken by it. We want their mind to be wrapped around it. So this is what you're going to do. Once you set it up, you're going to say to them, and as you feel your fingers lightly touching the table, you can close your eyes and allow yourself to be taken fully by the idea of that hand lifting. Allow yourself to be taken fully by the idea that that hand can lift all by itself and lifting all by itself. That's right. Now, you watch. If you see any lifting happening, you say, that's right. Okay, that's right. And then you want to coach further. If you don't see any lifting, just coach a little bit more and say, really go into the idea of the hand lifting all by itself to the point you can just begin to experience it happening. Really go there. Really allow yourself to be taken by the idea of the hand lifting. And I don't know how that hand feels as it lifts for you. So what we're doing here is we're explicitly inviting them to be taken by the idea, to allow it to happen. Any movement we see, we encourage it. Now, as I've used my language there, there's a lot of details and subtleties that you could go into as to the language structures. But what's more important is the idea underneath and the point that we are coaching someone to fully engage with an idea. We don't want to leave that to chance. So we don't want to say, so you may find after a time that hand lifts. No, we tell them, proactively engage with the idea. Now, the reason you want to have the eyes closed as you do this is because, number one, when people close their eyes, they often switch off their internal dialogue, their anchors to everyday experience drop away. And people don't spend their time awake with their eyes closed that much. So it sort of shifts their experience a little bit. But it also, if you've got someone who's a mismatcher who wants to make it not so, they don't get to sort of see it lift and then ask themselves the question, is this really happening? And interfere with it. You just want it to kind of happen all by itself and talk that hand up. And by the way, the key to the languaging here is the language of happening. Okay, you're asking them to do something, but you're asking them to do a happening. You're asking them to do the wrapping of their mind around an idea, the being taken by an idea. But you're encouraging the results of that to manifest and happen. So as the hand lifts, you encourage it more. And if somebody's really strongly responding, you can just go all out and go, yeah, that's right, lifting and lifting and just letting lifting happen. Letting lifting happen, the language of happening. So once it's come up for a certain point, this is another reason it's wonderful to have the eyes closed, because you invite them to open their eyes and look. You invite them to open their eyes and look, and when they open their eyes and look, a large amount of time, people will be surprised at how much their hand has moved. They'll be surprised at how much their hand has moved. Now, this is an experiment in mind-body connection. You can use this idea of placebo in the setup. But if you're an established hypnotist and you want to use this as a segue into something more classically trancey, you can just invite them to close their eyes again and go fully into an experience of profound relaxation. Because if they can be taken by the idea of a hand lifting, they can be taken by the idea of profound relaxation, they can be taken by any idea. They can be taken by the idea of themselves at their best in a particular situation where they wanted to change their response set. So all of these things are possible off the back of this. So you can use this as a vehicle into doing some more interesting stuff, some change work stuff. Okay, so I've just checked the time on this video. It's come out, of course, longer than I wanted it to be. But if you like the idea in the video, give me the thumbs up. Go for the like on it. If you're bold enough to go out and experiment, please do experiment and share your results in the comments section here. I would love to hear them. I'll give you any tips or feedback that come up if you hit any stumbling blocks. And also subscribe to the channel. Okay, if you haven't subscribed to the channel yet, make sure you subscribe to the channel. And I think that is all I need to say. If you want to learn more about this kind of approach to hypnosis, this pragmatic, process-based approach, you can always get the Hypnosis Mastery Program. There'll be a link somewhere around here too. Okay, take very good care until we speak again.